So the first section is 4.6, talk about what's called complex numbers. And the complex number system is bigger than the real number system. The real number system is inside of that. So it's kind of like, you know, this room is the real number system. The whole building is like the complex number system. So we're inside of the building, we're the real numbers. So we're inside of the complex numbers. So the complex numbers, what they deal with, they're written in general form. So this is, I guess we'll call it standard form. 4 a complex number. And a true complex number has a real part and an imaginary part. So the real part doesn't have an I, the imaginary part has an I. Okay, so this is what's called the real part. And this is what's called the imaginary part. Together, it makes a complex number because you're combining two different things, and that's compound, and makes it complex numbers, okay? Now, imaginary numbers, just a really unfortunate naming incident in math history, that there was a couple of guys that were pretty smart mathematicians. They were professors at, or I guess you would call them professors. They were teachers, and they were challenging each other to math questions because they were developing the same kind of theories at the same times, and they had met, and they didn't live in the same part of the world, so they would send letters to one another challenging each other, can you work this problem? And then that guy would work that problem, send his solutions, and then send him a harder problem, and they were challenging each other to try to get better. And they were doing polynomials, and they found out, they had this idea that whatever the degree of the polynomial was, they knew that would be that many answers. Like, we're dealing with quadratics right now, so that's degree 2, the highest exponent's 2. So there's how many answers to every quadratic? 2, okay? So they knew there were 2 answers, but there were some polynomials that they or some quadratics, they couldn't find them. But they knew there were 2 of them there because every quadratic that they had worked had 2 answers. So they started calling those the imaginary answers because they couldn't find them. They didn't have the skill to find them yet, but they called them imaginary. And that name kind of stuck. And they, through history, nobody ever changed it. They just said, okay, you know, it's kind of like, you know, cows. They named them cows way back then, and nobody's ever changed it. We still call them cows. Okay, so nobody ever changed the name of imaginary numbers because these guys had come up with it, and then they figured it out. They figured out how to find them. And the key to finding those imaginary solutions that they couldn't find was this definition. That's the square root of 1, the square root of negative 1, excuse me, is what we're going to call I, okay? That's the definition of the beginning of the complex number system, is that if we take the square root of a negative, the I is going to come out. So you can always simplify part of a square root of a negative with pulling an I out, and that takes care of the negative. So square root of negative 1 is defined as I, okay? In that same idea that I squared is negative 1. And we'll go the 4 rounds that it takes here. I to the 3rd power is negative I. Then I to the 4th power is positive 1. That little table right there is the key to working with complex numbers. When you start multiplying them, that's when it really is helpful. And we're going to do that some today. But that little table is the key to being able to work with complex numbers. This one is used for simplifying. We're going to do that first. And then these others are used for when we multiply, divide, that sort of thing with these. Okay, so there's a lot of, but once you get past out of the 4th, out of the 5th just starts over. And out of the 6th is same as I squared. Out of the 7th is the same as I cubed. Out of the 8th is the same as out of the 4th. it just keeps cycling through that same set of four answers for any power of I. You just got to divide it and find out which one it is. Loving Apple TV this week. I know you are too. All right. Sorry about that. All right. So let's look at some just basic simplifying of square roots that have a negative inside of them. Okay. The number part is exactly the same thing that we did the last couple of days. Okay. You're still going to break down the number. If it's a nice square number like 36, what's the square root of 36? 6. But because it's got a negative, it's going to be 6i. That's the only difference. Is if there's a negative inside of the square root, you got to remember there's an I that comes out as well. On one that's not a perfect square, like 24, you're still going to break it down, 8 and 3, or whatever numbers you use for 24. If you use 6 and 4, that's fine too. 4 and 2. There's a pair of 2s. So that 2 is what comes out. And because it's negative, an I also comes out. And then 6 is left on the inside. It's 3 times this 3 and this 2 multiply back together on the inside. So because it's negative, the I comes out. But as far as the number goes, you break it down the same way that we did yesterday and the day before. You're still going to break it down. On one like example C, just a negative 7. Does 7 break down? No, it's prime. So if it's prime, what can come out of that though? An I, and that's it. So it's I radical 7. Okay, so the negative just adds the I to the thing. It really doesn't complicate things that much. And it's like, okay, how come they didn't discover that quicker? You know, these guys were writing letters back and forth for years before they really figured this out. I mean, it's pretty simple. Negative 48, how's that work? Break it down. That'd be 8 and 6, 4 and 2, 2 and 2, 2 and 3. There's one, two pairs of 2s. So what's on the outside? 4i. What's left on the inside? 3. Okay. So simplifying them, same thing we've been doing. It just puts the I on if it's a negative on the inside. That's the only time that happens. If it's not a negative on the inside, you don't have the I. It's just a regular square root, and you're simplifying it the same way. Okay? All right. Well, let's look at some operations. And by operations, I mean addition, subtraction, multiplication. Addition is what we'll start with, and then we'll get to division last. It's the hardest one. So we have a complex number. We got a real part and an imaginary part, 8 plus 2i. And I'm going to add another complex number. Let's do 10 minus 3i. This is a very simple thing. It's just like adding polynomials. You're putting together the like terms. That's all you're doing. 8 plus 10, because they're like terms, they're regular numbers. That's the real parts. 8 plus 10 would be 18. 2i plus negative 3i. Negative I. And you've added two complex numbers. Very, very easy operation with complex numbers. Let's look at this. Negative 6 plus 4i minus 5 minus 8i. So a subtraction problem. Still doing the exact same thing. We're putting like terms together, just using a subtraction instead of addition. Negative 6 minus 5. Negative 11.
4i minus negative 8i.
Positive 12i. And that's it. Not crazy. All right. I want to show you a nice little feature of your graphing calculator with this. That's easy enough to do without the calculator, right? That's pretty easy to do. But your calculator can handle doing that if you just know how to type it in. So on the graphing calculator, if I were going to do example E, I would in parentheses type 8 plus 2, and to get the I, it's second and then the decimal point. Second and then the decimal point to get the I. And then plus, and then it was 10 minus 3i. 10 minus 3 second decimal point to get the I. And it should crank out 18 minus I. Is anybody getting an error on that? There may be a setting that we need to fix or something. If you're not getting the right, if it's not cranking it out, let me see here. Oh, because you get a negative score. Yeah, that's what it was. Anybody else troubles with that? All right. So we could do any of those that way. Now, that doesn't work like pretending that I is X and adding polynomials, like regular polynomials, because your calculator just remembers, oh, I is actually square root of negative 1, and it's kind of storing that in that place. So if you multiply, it's going to work it like it's I, not like it's an X. So don't think you can kind of cheat the system and do some polynomials that way, because it doesn't work that way. Your calculator's not going to do that. There are calculators that do, but we're not allowed to use them, so... This is where that actually becomes handy, because nobody likes working with fractions. So we have 2/3 plus 7i plus 1/5 minus 2i. That can be done by hand. It's fairly, they do fractions in elementary school. Common denominator would be 15. So that'd be 10 over 15. So I'm doing this by hand. But we're going to do it with the calculator, too. So that'd be 3 over 15. I don't have to get a common denominator on the I parts because they're already just regular numbers. I can just put those together. So that'd be 13 over 15 plus 5i. In the calculator, though, you don't even have to do much other than just type in the problem. 2/3 plus 7i. Plus 1/5 minus 2i. And here's the reason I want to show that on the calculator, is because it throws this decimal to me. Depending on how you have your calculator set, it's going to do that. To get it to change to a fraction, what do? Math, and then fract, enter twice. And there we have the 13 over 15 plus 5i. We got my hand. So it's a handy thing, especially when it comes to those fractions, because this is not something I don't expect them to ask you on the end of course test to add and subtract complex numbers with fractions all in them without a calculator. I really don't. If they're going to ask you to do that, they're going to do it with integers most likely. I really don't expect them to ask something that simple anyway. I always assume the worst, and they're going to ask you the hardest questions in the world is what I always assume. So. And from what I've heard, that's true. So let's look at multiplication. It's not much more difficult. It's actually easy. It did awesome. Such a good day. But it can't be as bad as yesterday. Came back. Yeah. Winning. All right. What property is that? Distributive property. It's still distributive property, even though it's complex numbers. We're distributing a straight up imaginary part to a complex number.
It's got a real part and an imaginary part. You multiply it, just distributed property like you always have. It's not changing anything. The only thing that's going to change is when we go to simplify it, because of it being complex numbers, there's some rules. So we distribute 5i to both of those pieces. That's going to give us 30i minus 35i squared. I times I is I squared. Just like x times x is x squared. So we're treating that I like it's a variable. It kind of is. So I times I is I squared, just like x times x is x squared. But here's the difference. We know what I squared is. What does I squared equal? Negative 1 from that little chart we had at the beginning. So we replace that I squared with the negative 1. And that gets that to be positive 35 plus 30i. And I write it in that order because that's the standard form for a complex numbers. The real part first and then the imaginary part. With your calculator, 5i multiplied by 6 minus 7i. Bum-ba-da-da. And it does it. It's smart. But you're smarter. Yeah, you are. I know you are. Let's multiply two complex numbers together. 9 minus 2i and 3 plus 4i. That's a lot like this. Y'all remember how to do that, right? Same thing over here. We just got numbers instead of mostly letters. Still got letters in it, though. So, depending on who you had for algebra, one, whether they talked about FOIL method or not. If you had me, I didn't talk about FOIL method. I just said distribute twice, which is what FOIL method is. Okay? 9 times 3 is 27, 9 times 4i would be 36i, and then you distribute the negative 2i. Negative 6i, negative 8i squared. Then you, hey.
I have 3 that wants sausage.
We don't have sausage. All right, so simplifying here, which ones are like terms? The two in the middle for sure are like terms. 36i minus 6i would be 30i. What about 27 and this? The I squared becomes negative 1, so this is really, 27 plus 8, 35. Think calculator can do that too? Yeah. It did. It did. Oh man. So minus 2i. And then 3 plus 4i. 35 plus 30i. Okay. Not bad. Not bad. Alright. Now let's look at how does this apply into solving equations with that? Well, oh, I forgot. Let's do division first. I forgot we got to do division. I want to get away from that. So let's do division first. The most simple version of division would be something where you have a real number or any, you could have a complex number on the top as well, but you've got an I in the denominator. That is just like the radical being in the denominator last section, because I is really a square root right in the denominator. We don't like that, so we need to rationalize that by getting rid of the I in the denominator by just multiplying by I over I in this case. So that would be 3i over I squared. But we know I squared is really what? Negative 1. Yeah, so it just makes it negative 3i. If it's 6 plus 5i, I got a complex number in the top and just an imaginary number in the bottom. Which part of this bottom part is the problem? The 7 or the I? Which part is really a radical? The I is the radical. The 7 is a number. It's just a regular number. The I is the problem. So if it's just an imaginary number in the bottom, we're going to multiply by I over I. And that's going to give us 7i squared in the bottom. The top part, it's distributive property, so that's 6i plus 5i squared. We can simplify those by making it, okay, well, that makes that negative 5 plus 6i over negative 7. Because I squared is negative 1, so that's where the negative 5 comes from. The 6i didn't change. So I'm just distributing I to 6 and I to 5i to get this next step. That's what I'm doing. Here, I times I is I squared. So that's where that's coming from. Now, you'll never see this left this way with a negative on the bottom. They're always just going to run the negative through the top and change the signs to positive 5 minus 6i over 7. Or 5 over 7. Minus 6 over 7i. Now, the beauty of the calculator is in the division. Like the addition and subtraction, I probably wouldn't do those in the calculator just because it takes me longer to type them in than it would to just do it. The multiplication, maybe I would do those in the calculator. Yeah, come on, just a minute. This will be fine. Thank you. Gage, did you say you forgot to write your name again? Oh, okay. All right. That's it. All right. So with the calculator, the division really gets a lot better. The only thing you've got to be careful of with the calculator and doing the division is parentheses. The numerator needs to be in parentheses. The denominator needs to be in parentheses. So we would put, 6 plus 5i over 7i. There we go. 6 plus 5i divided by, and I'm going to put 7i in parentheses. I don't really have to on that case, but I'm just want to be careful getting that habit. And it cranks out something ugly like this. But that's decimals. How do we change it to fractions? Math, enter, squared. And there we have our 5 over 7 minus 6 over 7i. Your calculator is going to write it like that every time because that's standard form for a complex number. You got the real part and an imaginary part separate. You will see this answer more often than you will see this. Not saying that you will never see answers like that, but you will see this answer style more. And it's just splitting the denominator to each one. You know, it's a common denominator is all it is. All right. So what if it's complex number 7 minus 8i over 9 plus 2i? Here we've got a complex number in the denominator, complex number in the numerator. Yes, I know we can type it straight into the calculator, but what is the calculator doing when we do that? It's multiplying by the conjugate. Just like yesterday, you had the ones that had a radical plus another number in the denominator. You always make the conjugate. The conjugate changes the sign in the middle to be that. 9 minus 2i. Whatever the denominator is, change the sign in the middle, and it's the conjugate. Then multiply. 9 times 7, 3. 9 times 8. Be negative 72i minus 14i plus 16i squared. We got some simplifying to do up there. On the bottom part, 9 times 9 is 81. 9 times negative 2i be negative 18i. Positive 2i times positive 9 is positive 18i. Positive 2i and negative 2i be negative 4i squared. What happens to those middle pieces there? They go away. So the shortcut for that would be square this and square that and subtract them. That's going to be the denominator. And what do we know about the I squareds? They're really negative ones. So you replace those, you end up with 63 minus 16, which would be, and then 81 plus 4 on the bottom, which would be 85. And then what's 63 minus 16? 47. And then we get the I's together. 72 and 14 would be 86. I. 47 over 85. 86 over 85. I. Those would be those answers. Now, again, we could type this into the calculator, and it's going to crank out that answer for us, which is a beautiful thing when you're in a hurry. I have no idea what the question was. 7 minus 8i. But you have to use parentheses. 9 plus 2i. If you don't use those parentheses, it's not going to crank out the correct answer. Math, enter, squared. And there we have 47 over 85 minus 86 over 85i. You got that. All right. So now let's take this, the idea of the imaginary numbers and the complex number system, and apply it to solving some equations by square roots. So what letter are we on? So, 2x squared plus 11 equals negative 37. All right. So this is kind of some of the issues I saw with the quiz as I was, I didn't grade them all, but as I was grading through some of them. You've got to get the x squared by itself first. Don't take square roots until you get x squared by itself. That seemed to happen with not everybody, but some people, more than I was hoping for. Y'all were taking square roots too soon. You got to get x squared by itself. So we're going to subtract 11. And you got negative 37 minus 11 would be negative 48. And then you need to divide by 2. The x squared is now by itself, and this is where I take the square root. And I don't forget my plus and minus. 24, what happens to it? Okay, well, that's 12 and 2. That's 6 and 2. And that's 3 and 2. So I got a pair of 2s and a 6 left over. But what else comes out because it's a negative 24? An I. Plus or minus 2i radical 6. Those are the solutions there to that equation. So it takes the same skill set. The only thing we're adding is that if it's negative when you take the square root, pull an I out as well. That's really the only thing we're adding. Let's do this one. X minus 3 squared plus 19 equals 1. What's the first step? Got to get 19 on the other side. Can't take the square root until the squared part is by itself. So I got to move the 19 first. X minus 3 squared equals negative 18. Now the squared part is by itself. The parentheses is the squared part. So we can get rid of the squared by taking the square roots. Plus or minus on the side that's a number. And this is going to give us x minus 3. And I'm thinking 18. Well, that's 9 and 2. 3 and 3. Pair of 3s. But it's plus or minus 3. What? I, because it was a negative 18. Then square root of 2 left over. Now, x is not quite by itself yet. How do I get x by itself? I'm going to add 3 to both sides. But I can't add 3 to this thing and get 6i radical 2 because they're not like terms. This thing has a radical and an I on it. This 3 we're adding doesn't have either of those. So they're not like terms. So I'm just going to write it x equals 3 plus or minus 3i radical 2. And that's the two solutions. One is 3 plus 3i radical 2. One is 3 minus 3i radical 2. Okay. Nothing else we can do to that one. Let's do one more. Let's say we had 4 parentheses x. Minus 6 squared minus 10 equals negative 11. Okay. What's the first step in this problem? Add 10. Good. That's negative 1. X minus 6 squared, 4 out in front. Divide by that 4. Got to get rid of that because the squared part's not by itself yet. I'm going to leave that as a fraction. Negative 1 fourth. Now I can take the square roots because the squared part is by itself. Plus or minus on the side that's just a number. So that's x minus 6. And then I'm going to think, okay, what's the square root of 1 fourth? That's the square root of 1 over the square root of 4. What's the square root of 1? 1. What's the square root of 4? 2. So it's 1 half, but it's not just 1 half. It's 1 half I. Good job. Because it was a negative 1 fourth that we were dealing with. So anytime we see a negative inside that square root, you got to get that I out there. It's plus or minus in front of that. Now, what do I do to get x by itself? Add 6 to both sides. I can't combine 6 and 1 half because that 1 half's got a what on it? I. They're not like terms. One's a real number. One's an imaginary number. They're not even the same kind of number, so I can't put them together. I can just write them as 6 plus or minus 1 half I. 6 plus 1 half I is the one answer. 6 minus 1 half I is the second answer. Okay. John. What do you mean two variables? That was on the first three. Those were factoring problems. Not do by square. Yeah, the first three had that. They were factoring problems. You couldn't do those by square roots. Now, Monday, we're not going to get to it today. So tomorrow will be a work day over doing just the complex numbers and solving these simple ones. Monday, we're going to talk about how to turn those kind of problems into problems that can be done like this. And it's called completing the square. We'll get to that Monday. We're a little bit, if you talk to folks from Coach Mack's class, we're a little behind them, like by one day. So it'll be 2 days by Monday, but that's okay. All right, so on page 279, I want to make sure I got the solving ones in there because I'd actually plan on doing two. This is 279.
Let's do three. Let's do numbers three through 33.
Okay, that'll get us.
That'll get you some solving. There at the beginning, you're solving. You're going to have to, you know, get x squared or whatever variable squared by itself first, and then take square roots. Get that done, and it'll get you the operations with the complex numbers as well, through 33 there, and that'll kind of set us up for Monday stuff.
Oh, so 3 through 33, all of them, is what we'll do for tomorrow's work day.
Oh, yeah.